grace and peace to all of you in the name of Jesus. During this Lenten season, I would like to reflect on the passage where Jesus is brought before Annas. I would like to see this passage from the angle of nepotism. Lenten Meditation, Day 13. The word nepotism comes from the Latin word nepos, meaning nephew or grandchild. It refers to giving unfair advantages to your own family if you are in a position of power, especially by giving them jobs. Nepotism, which completely disregards merit, is a pandemic all over the world, and the church is no exception. The practice of nepotism has raised concerns because it challenges the growth of the church by being out tune with the values of God's reign. John chapter 18 verses 12 to 14 and Matthew 26 verses 57 and 58 talk about the trial of Jesus before Annas and Caiaphas. The dynamics of the relationship they both shared leads us to believe that Jesus was a victim of nepotism, which gathered momentum and led to his crucifixion. The family of high priest, headed by Annas, clearly had a vested interest in doing away with Jesus. Caiaphas, the incumbent high priest, and Annas, his father-in-law, who Caiaphas had succeeded, were involved in nepotism of the worst kind. For all through the time, Jesus was tried, condemned, and crucified, Caiaphas, as the high priest, was the chief actor behind the scenes as well as on stage. Both Annas and Caiaphas were Sadducees who did not believe in the resurrection, and so made out a strong case for condemning Jesus. Annas was appointed as the high priest by the Roman authority, but his son Eleazar replaced him. Eleazar himself was deposed after 2 years, and Caiaphas, who succeeded him, presided over the trial and condemnation of Jesus. Even after Caiaphas' tenure ended in AD 37, four more sons of Annas were to succeed Caiaphas consecutively. This highest parliamentary forum of the Jews and the source of the political maneuvering of the Romans became a family parliament. The family even moved the courtroom from its traditional location to the house of the high priest in the market. This high office of priest was held consecutively by the five sons and the son-in-law of Annas. His family was not only wealthy, but also tightly knit, and so influential that they could grease the palms of the Romans, who had the authority to appoint or depose the high priest. The temple business, which infuriated Jesus, was a solid source of income for the priest family. It was the family of Caiaphas that controlled the temple and its treasury, as well as the currency exchange rates and fixed the price of sacrificial animals. No wonder Jesus said that they had turned the temple into a den of robbers. Jesus was obviously perceived as a threat to the family business. Caiaphas had already made it clear that he intended to sacrifice Jesus in order to save the nation. What he actually meant was that Jesus would have to be sacrificed for the sake of his family. Talmud, the book of Jewish law and traditions, records a curse on Annas' family. I quote, "Woe to the sons of Annas, themselves high priest, their sons treasurers, their son-in-law assistant treasurers, while their servants beat the people with sticks," unquote. We can understand how Nepotism was the driving force in the condemnation and crucifixion of Jesus. In the Old Testament, we see instances of kings appointing people within the family to important positions because of the impending threat to the life of the king. Nehemiah, after finishing the task of reconstructing the walls, appoints his brother Hanani as governor of Jerusalem. When Joseph's family come to Egypt to escape famine, he gives his family the best part of the land. However, in the Gospels, we find Jesus expanding the meaning of being and becoming the family of God in doing His will, found in Matthew chapter 12, verse 46 to 50. The Bible wants us to be aware of the menace of nepotism and implores us to be fair and impartial in our dealings, not just with our family, but also with others. In Acts 10, verses from 1 to 35, we see Peter at the house of Cornelius to understand how true it is that God does not show favoritism, but accepts from every nation the one who fears Him and does what is right. Paul, while writing to Timothy, exhorts him to be without bias, doing nothing in a spirit of partiality. It is sad, therefore, that many in the church are involved in acts that reek of nepotism, and which have led to not just mistrust, corruption, and conflicts within the body of Christ, but also to the avowedly faithful, particularly the younger generation, losing faith in the church. A honest approach to the work of the church is demanded of those in responsible positions, as they are directly accountable to the laity. Nepotism can create a vicious circle of unjust systems, deprive the meritorious and deserving of what is rightly theirs, and corrupt the functioning of the church. We are clearly obliged to show care and concern for members of our family, but we should ensure that this does not conflict with principles of equity and fair play. Nepotism-driven trial of Jesus always remind us to be aware of the decisions we make as a church, and help us practice being fair, impartial, and transparent. Amen. Let us pray. Dear God, who is just in all your ways, guide us, your church, towards a vision of impartial and non-discriminatory thinking and practices. Free us from the clutches of selfishness that seek to further our own interest, and steer us towards the praxis of equity for all. Amen.